if it's on the beam, featuring Dad. So first, you go onto the beam or floor, wherever you're going to be practicing. And then you go up in releve, up on your toes. And then you turn, and then you step again, and then you turn, and then you finish. Come on, Dad, it's your turn.
Okay.
And then you step again.
Step left over?
Yes, and then you pivot again, and then you finish. This has been Gym Time with Annie, sponsored by Athletic Edge Gymnastics.
What you reading?
Kingdom
Keepers. Kingdom Keepers.
What you reading?
I am reading Lonely on the Mountain. It's a Louis L'Amour book.
What you reading?
Give me my camera. What are you doing? Give me my camera back.
No.
Don't let your kids watch it.
Okay, we're here with our Keeper of the Magic, our former Disney expert. Well, she's still an expert, but she's a former employee of Disney. Aunt Chelsea here. And Annie and I have been reading some things out of this awesome book while we have so much time on our hands. Yeah, there you go. Now you can see it. But we wanted to confirm with an actual employee if he's real or not, because they sound pretty crazy. Right? Okay, so we have some questions for you. So, if you're ready, are you ready over there?
I'm ready.
Okay. Is it true that there are feral cats roaming Disneyland to keep the rodent population down?
Yes, it is. It's very true. They'll actually roam not just the parks, but they'll also roam the parking lots where the employees park, hoping to get some treats from them, which they usually do. And there's one cat in particular that actually has his own Instagram. His name is Francisco.
Really?
Yeah. They post a picture of him every Friday, Francisco Fridays.
Okay. Well, there we go. So all of our questions today are kind of animal-based questions. That's okay. The section we're in our book. So is it true that there is a real pet cemetery at the Haunted Mansion? I know there's rumors.
So a lot of people think that it's a bigger secret than it is, but really that pet cemetery is just that little tiny pet cemetery when you walk up to the very front of the Haunted Mansion, where they have like tombstones for the pets that have gone beyond now.
Okay.
But it's not a real pet cemetery.
There's not real dead animals in there, because I've read conflicting arguments that say Imagineers have buried their actual pets in that section. So
if they have, they're keeping it a secret even from us.
Okay. Right. So one of the other things we read about, and we actually experienced this firsthand when we were at Walt Disney World, was that when Walt was creating Disneyland, he wanted actual real animals, like in the Jungle Cruise and stuff. And so I know when we were at Walt Disney World, we saw an alligator like near Tom Sawyer's Island. So we wondered, is there actual alligators in like Disneyland too? Have you ever seen that?
I have not seen any alligators, but they did used to have some wildlife. They have horses. They had the pygmy goats.
Mm-hmm.
They also, I believe, and you'll have to look this up, but I believe they used to have some live animals at their show in Adventureland too. They don't anymore, but
okay. All right. So you never seen any alligators or anything in the rivers of America?
Oh, There was not alligators, but there was a time when they had fish.
What?
In the rivers of America.
Oh, and
I don't know if that is in your book or not.
I haven't got to that part yet, but like, so would they be like there was fish, like they stocked the lake?
Yeah, yeah. So they put real fish in the lake in hopes that guests would come and they would actually go fishing with Tom Sawyer at the Rivers of America. But they stopped doing that because it actually got to be pretty stinky because people wouldn't take their fish home with them and they would leave them around the park.
All right. We'll have to do a little more research on that one. Okay, well, thank you, the expert, for spending a few minutes with us and sharing some Disneyland knowledge and being a part of the magic. Maybe we'll see you again next week.
Sounds good.
All right.
Bye.
Bye.
This is our first Lego competition, building competition between Annie and Cody.
I'm gonna win.
There's gonna be an example underneath here. You have to build it exactly to how it is.
Okay.
When you're done, you bring it to me to inspect, and I will tell you if you've got it or not, okay?
Okay.
No picking this up. You can only visually look at it.
Okay.
Okay? You both have the exact same thing underneath your tin there. Yes. Your marks. Get set. Go. Oh, let me inspect. Not done yet until I have
checked
every single piece here. And it looks like Cody does, in fact, have his man created. Nice job, Cody. There you go.
Woo!
Hey, Annie, why don't you pick out an album?
Okay.
Oh, what you got there? All right. The Beatles, Abbey Road. All right.
First issued on September 26, 1969. Abbey Road was the final Beatles album to be recorded, but not their last to be released. Let It Be, though, mainly recorded in January 1969, was finally released in May 1970, alongside to the film of the same name. For the first time on a Beatles album, the front cover contained neither the group's name nor the album title, just that iconic photograph taken on the zebra crossing near the entrance to the studios in London, NW8, in August 1969. Abbey Road entered the British album chart at number one in October and stayed there for a total of 17 of its 81 weeks in the chart. In the U.S., it spent 11 weeks at number one during its initial chart stay of 83 weeks.
This is what the Beatles had to say about Abbey Road. Paul said, "I don't like people explaining albums. The only way you can explain it is to hear it. You can't really use words about music, otherwise we do a talking album. The album is the explanation and it's up to you to make sure what you want of it." George felt similar, saying, "Maybe when I get the album finished and in the sleeve, I'll get some sort of expression to it. When When I did Pepper and the White Album, I got an overall image of the album, but with this one, I'm kind of lost. We spent hours doing it, but I still don't see it like us. It's more like somebody else. It's a very good album. Ringo, on the other hand, said the second side of Abbey Road is incredible. The White Album, 99% of it is very good. If I had Desert Island Discs, I'd take the White one or Abbey Road, I think. I like the boys playing together, you know. I like a group. John, apparently, was never a big fan of the Beatles. He said, Abbey Road for me, just like with all of the Beatles albums, I like some tracks and I don't like others. It's always been the same. I've never been a knocked-out Beatles fan and wanted to buy any of our albums. I like some of the work we did and some of our work I didn't, but Abbey Road was a competent album. This has been Annie Picks an Album, featuring Beatles' Abbey Road.
When you can't decide with your own two eyes, and you're not allowed to go outside, just call Eli and you will find that he knows it all. The Biology Guy.
This week, Desert Tortoises.
We have Uncle Eli, the Biology Guy, here with us today. And Annie and I, we're going over a little life science today, and we had a discussion on what the differences between turtles and tortoises are. So we thought we would get to our expert, our resident family expert on all things animal, and ask him what the difference between turtles and tortoises is, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
All right, well, turtles and tortoises belong to the same group. They're both chelonians. It's the order chelonians. But all tortoises are turtles, but not necessarily all turtles are tortoises. But the easy way to distinguish them is turtles generally live in the water only, and tortoises live on land, with a couple of small exceptions, like the box turtle and the wood turtle. Both live on land, but yeah, essentially tortoises live on land. Turtles usually live in the water.
Okay. So yeah, where would you find a desert tortoise or something that we might see?
Well, like it says in the name, usually you find the desert tortoise in the desert. Where they are is actually, there's kind of two things about them. Desert tortoises in, I think it was 1989, they did a study and they found out that there's actually two species of tortoises, and they're separated by the Colorado River. So if you can see this picture here, that orangish red section is divided from this blue section by the Colorado River, where it comes up at the base of Colorado and all the way down into Mexico. And so in Southern California, Southeast California, Southwest Utah, Southern Nevada, so everything north and west of the Colorado River is the Mojave Desert Tortoise, and everything to the east and south of the Colorado River, going down into Sinaloa, Mexico, and through eastern Arizona, is the Sonoran Desert Tortoise. And the desert tortoise you'll mostly find not only in the desert in those regions, the Southwest United States, generally for most of the year, they're going to be underground. And then in the springtime, you might find them above ground during a short window from April to, say, June-ish, usually. This is where you'd see them be the most active.
Okay. You have other questions?
How big can they get?
Oh, so the desert tortoises, when they're born, they hatch out of an egg that's about the size of a ping pong ball. And they're folded up in there. So they kind of fold up to about twice the width of a ping pong ball when they're born. And then they can get to be, I guess it's probably about 15 to 18 inches. We measure it in millimeters. So probably about 320 millimeters is as long as they get. And that's measured using what's called an MCA gill or medial carapace length, and it's measured from this scute right here, which is called the nuchal on the top, right above the head, to the supracaudal scute right here at the bottom, and that's where their tail would come out.
Okay. So how long does it take before they get full grown? Like, how many years does it take for them to get from ping pong ball size to full grown?
So tortoises have a pretty, desert tortoises anyways, have a pretty similar lifespan to humans, generally living from about 50 to 80 years long. 80 years would be under optimal conditions, plenty of water, no droughts, good vegetation, or in captivity. You know, 50 years is going to be more what you usually see in the wild if they survive that long.
Are they considered endangered? That was one of Annie's questions.
So, yes. In the early 90s, they were listed by both the California State Endangered Species List and the Federal Endangered Species List as threatened, which is one tier below endangered. And there's a lot of things that have put the tortoise in that way. They used to be much, much more abundant in the historic range that I showed you on that map. They used to spread out even further than that. And there's a lot of reasons that they think that the tortoise, that have contributed to why the tortoise has declined. One is human encroachment or loss of habitat, with humans building and developing areas. Another is predation, and one of the most common predators that they find today is that for juvenile tortoises, one of the reasons they don't live that long, or not that many of them get that old, is because ravens will go and predate the juvenile tortoises. And so remember I was saying about that 180 millimeter length, that's about the time when tortoise shells start hardening up. Up until that point, baby tortoises, young tortoises, are actually squishy. You could actually hurt them if you squeeze their shell too hard. They're kind of soft. And so ravens find them really delicious and easy to eat when they're that small.
What do they eat?
Let me get to that in one second. Let me finish what I was talking about with the raven.
Okay, sorry.
So one of the reasons that the ravens are there more now also has to do with humans. Ravens didn't used to be as abundant, but now they follow humans to wherever they're at. So when humans leave trash around or water fields and leave puddles of water, these things all make ravens go, oh, that's a great place to be. And when we do that in the desert where the desert tortoise is, then they find the tortoise too. And so that's another reason why they're on the conservation list.
Kind of led into, you know, they were food for ravens. So we wondered what they were eating out there in the desert, since there's not a lot of food sources out there for them.
Right. So desert tortoises are herbivores, and generally what they'll eat is grasses, which they can kind of find year round, but usually they like to eat more wet, greener grasses, and tortoises aren't out year round. But they love flowers, and particularly flowers on cactus, blooming cactus, but they'll also eat the leaves of the cactus as well. So flowers, grasses, leaves, but they're general herbivores. They like to eat that. An interesting little side bit on that is that we've actually found young tortoises chasing down caterpillars during sphinx moth. Caterpillars will have huge blooms where there's a bunch of them everywhere, and we've found tortoises chasing them down, and they get the same nutrition because those caterpillars eat the same plants that they're eating.
Huh.
But that's about the only time we really document them eating anything other than plants.
What can I do to protect them?
Oh, what can you do to protect them? Well, the first thing you can do is if you're in desert tortoise habitat and you see a tortoise, take a step back. You always want to give a tortoise their space, because if a tortoise gets scared, it can do what's called voiding. And being that they live in the desert, they don't get a lot of water. Voiding means that what they're doing is they're peeing. And they're getting, but when they do it as a deterrent, and they let all the fluid out of their body, out of their system. So one of the things about tortoises is when they're babies, you know, they're less than half a pound. It's like 0.05 pounds. And as adults, if they're in the spring season, there's been plenty of rain, they can weigh as much as 11 pounds, but they can triple their weight by the amount of water that they get in the spring. And so if you scare a tortoise, it'll void and let all that water go. And if it doesn't rain, they can become dehydrated and get sick or die and not make it through the rest of the year. So you always want to give a tortoise its space so that it doesn't do that. If you're out on, say, like a national park trip, which I know you guys like to do, and Joshua Tree is a great place to see desert tortoises. If you see a tortoise in the road, make sure you're going super slow. Give it its space and don't even bother moving it out of the road unless it's in imminent danger. We actually have a lot of people at Joshua Tree who will stay there and be a crossing guard for tortoises and make sure cars see them and move around them. But if it's in imminent danger, one's on the highway or something like that, you can actually move it out of the road, even though that's technically considered harassment because they're protected because they're on the endangered species list. But you always want to move a tortoise in the direction that it's going, because if you don't, he'll just turn around and go back. They're super stubborn. Those are the big things that you can do is, you know, be concerned about trash and things like that and give them their space.
All right. Well, thanks, Uncle Eli, for spending a few minutes with us and letting us know everything you know about tortoises. I'm sure there's a lot more we can get into, but maybe that's for the next one.
All right.
Stay safe up there in Big Bear, and maybe we'll see you again next week.
All right, sounds good. Talk to you guys later.
Okay.
This has been the Biology Guy.